Bible is God's word. He inspired it for us. He speaks through it to us.
Speak this over yourself this morning.
I think science really should be the study of God's majesty, of his awesomeness. That's what we're doing with science. We're trying to find out more about God's creation.
What this verse is saying is you look around and it has the stamp of an incredible creator, designer, artist all over it.
We are lovingly made by a God who wants a relationship with us. That's why Christianity is so important to me, because it is everything. Without it, we have literally nothing.
So I know deep down, however you've suppressed it, deep down, you have a sense that God is. You know that God is.
Yes, I am who you say I am. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free.
What's more reasonable to believe? That an eternal God made the world, or that it made itself? That's what a banner does. It announces something with pride about somebody. Listen to this. His banner over you is love.
Oh, good morning, guys. If I can ask you all to quickly take your seats, that'd be perfect. Dodgy. Welcome to Baglan Community Church, guys. If it's the first time you've come here, you're more than welcome. Please stay behind afterwards. There are refreshments, over to my left. And we've got Andy here this morning from 10 of those. So you can see all the books at the back there. There's some really great books there. So afterwards, I expect to see you spending your money at the back. That would be great. As well as that, the only other announcement we got for you this morning is that we have Food and Faith tonight, which starts at 6 o'clock, I believe. So aside from that, we have a communion service today as well. So what we're going to do today, we're going to take communion around about the second or third song. We've gone back to the old school ways. So we've no longer got the little cup, so I'm not going to hear any rustling like you're walking on leaves here this morning. So you're back to the guys handing it out. So for the purpose of the guys handing it out, if you can hand the elements out after the first song, that would be perfect. But before we go any further, I just want to pray for us, and then I'm going to read a passage from Romans, and then we're going to stand and we're going to sing together, all right? So God, we thank you for this morning. God, we thank you, God, that we can meet together as a body of believers. God, that we can meet and lift up your name in song. Hear your word preached here. And we just pray that today, God, you will meet with us by your spirit, that you will speak powerfully, God. God, we don't want anything here that is man-made, fabricated. God, we really want to know you here today. God, we really want you to speak. God, we really want you to save. God, we pray for that this morning, God. And as we take communion together here today, God, we just ask of God for a few moments, God, where it becomes very, very real to us, God, what you have done. The body broken, the blood spilt for us. God, as we prayed only moments ago, God, we really see, God, where we were to where we are now. And it's all because of Jesus. God, help us to take this seriously. Help us to really be filled with joy as we reflect on what you've done, God, and where we stand in you now, God. In your precious name. Amen. Let me share this with you. If you can just bow your heads, close your eyes. I'm just going to read a little bit from Romans. It says this: you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. So we stand together and sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall
read this passage from Isaiah. If the guys can pass out the elements now, that'd be perfect. Thank you. So as I read this out, I just want to encourage you guys just to bow your heads, close your eyes, and start reflecting on the words that I'm going to be reading. It says this: who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering to sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. That is our Jesus here today. That's what we're remembering. That he took all our sin and all our shame. As we pray, Father, we just thank you, God, for who you are, God. We thank you, God, that we have this time here today just to be able to reflect on that. This time here today just to get right with you, God. God, forgive us, God, if we have been distracted by what's going on out there, God, that we forget this incredible and amazing truth, God, that you saved us, God, that you give us your perfect son, Jesus, that he died on that cross, that he suffered all of your wrath so that we didn't have to. God, thank you that you made a way. Thank you for all that you've done in your precious name. Amen. We're going to sing In Christ Alone now, but I just like to, if you want to just sit, we as a band will sing, you sing along, but just bow your heads and just listen to these words, and after we've sung In Christ Alone, we'll take communion together.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, take and eat. This is my body." Should we eat together? Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins." Shall we drink together? No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hands till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I stand. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God, that those of us who are in Christ here this morning can proclaim that. God, to know that we are safe in your hands, to know that you have given it all for our freedom. And we just thank you, God. We thank you, God, from the bottom of our hearts here today, God, that you have made a way. And pray, God, as we prayed already, that you forgive us, God, if we have strayed off the path. God, we've strayed away. God, restore us here this morning, we pray. Focus our hearts and our minds, God, on you. God, that we walk every day in your ways. God, we pray, God, for the rest of this service now, God, that you will speak, God. God, as we stand in a moment and respond, God, we will respond like free people, God. We respond like a people who know what we've been saved from. We respond like a people who know the glorious inheritance that we now have in you, that can never perish, spoil, or fade. God, we just thank you for all that you are in your precious name. Amen. Should we stand together and sing our last song before the message?
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. Blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the bridge was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm,
Ask Andy now from 10 of those to come up and share a little bit with us. Thank you.
Morning, everybody. It's lovely to be here with you in Wales. I'm from a small town just outside of Wales called England, but please don't let that put you off coming to browse our books. If you've not met 10 of those before, we basically, in simple terms, we are passionate about Jesus. We believe books that point to him can change people's lives. And so I've brought some good stock with me today. I'd like to recommend some of our favourites. We love to recommend biographies, stories about our real God, real people, and how our amazing God's power can work through just normal people to do wonderful things in the earth is just so encouraging for us. This one, To a Different Drum, a story about Pauline Hamilton, her story. Pauline grew up in America and she was struggling a little bit with life. She got trapped in the grip of drugs and drink and was spiraling down, really. And so one day she got in a car, she started driving towards a cliff and the plan was to drive off the end of it. But we believe God popped a tire in a car, bringing it to a halt and changing the direction of her life. It was the first domino in a series of events that led her to God and to get to know him. And an amazing story how she just ended up with feeling called to the nation of China to go over there to serve the people, to take the good news of Christ and does wonderful things out there. And amazing as well to know that actually her mum prayed for her when she was just a baby and said, Lord, my baby is for the nation of China. And God answered that prayer as well. So a real encouraging story there, To a Different Drum. And so please have a think about that one today. I've got a book here, Impossible Christianity. Do you ever feel a little bit like our walk sometimes is a little bit tough? Turn of this year, I thought, right, I'm going to start reading the Bible every day and I'm going to start getting fit as well. And I've missed lots of days of the Bible. And yesterday I pulled my calf when I went for a run. And sometimes it just doesn't quite work out sometimes, does it? But Kevin DeYoung is just real about the fact life is difficult and life is tough. And actually relieving a lot of the pressure, which sometimes we can put on ourselves as followers of Christ. Sometimes we may feel pressured to be the one to bring revival and be the one to do all the work that's needed. But Kevin DeYoung, very biblically based, takes us through some things even like topics like justification and actually helps us just work those out into normal life as we just follow Christ and seek to glorify him. And Kevin DeYoung has got this encouraging book, Impossible Christianity, to help us on our walk with him. To encourage you in your devotional time, I thought this one would be a good one to mention. Meeting Christ in the Garden by Tim Chester, based on the Song of Songs. Sometimes it's difficult, isn't it, to just find bits of gold in Scripture that we may not be quite as familiar with as some other parts of Scripture. And the Song of Songs may be one of those. In fact, I don't think I've read it since marriage prep. But the Song of Songs is just an interesting one. And I think to be walked through by Tim Chester, and what he does is he brings some friends with him, drawing on wisdom from some church fathers, Martin Luther and Charles Spurgeon and the rest of the gang. He just brings wisdom and unwraps the Song of Songs, helps us a day at a time. So there's 90 devotionals, so it could last you 3 months. Or if you're like me, you miss a day or two, it could last you half a year. But Meeting Christ in the Garden, based on the Song of Songs, a devotional for us there. Something for our little ones. I've been really happy that little Thomas has helped me with the books this morning at the back, and it's great to see your little ones bouncing around downstairs in the room. This one, The Friends and the Traveller. Sam Brewster and Hannah Green write this wonderful poem where we basically jump into the story. We're on the road to Emmaus, and two friends are talking about the wonderful things they've seen back in Jerusalem and this amazing person that they've seen and met and encountered. And then there's the traveller who's walking with them, and there's this great poem and fantastic rhyming and telling us that story. And obviously in the end we discover that this amazing traveller is, of course, oh, you've read it already, Jesus, yes. So The Friends and the Traveller, wonderful poem. I won't do it justice, but do come and have a flick through that if you're interested in that. And finally, if I could just encourage you to think about maybe the people who aren't in church yet, who maybe don't know the wonderful news of Jesus. This one, 12 things you probably didn't know about Easter. A real fun way of introducing people to the gospel. We're coming up to Easter, aren't we? Does anybody like hot cross buns? Quick show of hands, hot cross buns, yep. Does anybody like baking hot cross buns? Or no, you're just all gifted to eat them like me. Did you know, though, that at one time it was illegal to actually bake hot cross buns? Not many people know that. Did you know, actually, they also broke 18 laws as they put Jesus on the cross on Good Friday? And then did you know that the cross of Christ was for you as he died in your place? And so it's got a wonderful way of taking us through some weird and wonderful facts of Easter, the traditions down the ages, and leads you a step at a time into that gospel story. And so a real fun one, kind of a non-threatening way of giving that out to our friends, maybe on the playground, down your street, or if you're on the bus, you could just kind of sit on it and leave it, and maybe the next person will read it and pick it up, and it'll be nice and warm for them as well. And so 12 things you probably didn't know about Easter, just £1 to maybe think about giving away. So we take cash, card, contactless cake, Apple Pay, Apple Pie, whatever you've got, we'll take it. And you can come and connect with us, and we'll give you a free ebook every week. And so I'll hopefully see you in the bookstall afterwards, and I'll hand over to Neil. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much, Andy. Tenor, those are a great book company, actually. We've been using them for a long time. If you are ever thinking, where can I go to get books that are going to be safe? Ten of those are safe. They really are. So you know that every book they sell has been rigorously checked theologically so that they only stock really solid stuff. So honestly, they're great. Probably the cheapest bookstore out there as well online in terms of getting your books. So if you ever think, you know, where do I get a Christian book from? Do a check on 10 of those as well online, because they're normally cheaper than the majority. Okay, guys. Oh, I got an announcement. Hannah asked me to say that the paint-along lady, what is a paint-along lady? Whatever that is, the paint-along lady, she just needs the money for that in the next week. So by next weekend, I think she needs the money for that. I think you guys probably know it, but if you don't know, see Hannah afterwards and she can explain that to you. We're in the book of Acts, guys. We're in chapter 4 this morning, so it'll be on the screen, but it's always better if you've got a Bible with you or an electronic version to look through. I've entitled this morning, kind of vaguely, Telling People About Jesus. Contextually, it's kind of telling people about Jesus when you're scared to do so, or telling people about Jesus when you face opposition, or telling people about Jesus when it's really difficult to do so. That's the kind of the theme this morning. I think for the majority of us, right, we find it scary telling people about Jesus. So the big theme of the book of Acts is it's about telling people what Jesus has done, right? But when we think about telling people what Jesus has done, we also think about how people will respond to that. And we're saying, listen, you need Jesus. And then we imagine that they'll come back with, but how do you know that you're right? What right have you got to tell me that what you're saying is right and that I'm saying is wrong, and then everybody else is wrong? And we just flummox us then, right? And we think about what people may say in response, and the thought of what they might say in response and how that would make us feel paralyzes us. So then we think, I just can't tell anybody the gospel. I can't do it. And so we don't do it. So this morning is kind of looking through, how did the apostles do it? And how can we learn from the apostles, even in extremely difficult situations, how do we learn to tell people about Jesus? So this is chapter 4. We're going to go through most of the text, first of all, 1 to 21, 2, and make the first two points, and then the third point will be the few verses after that. So this is chapter 4, verse 1. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, so that the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. So if the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000, if you include women and children as well, maybe 10, 15,000 people already in a matter of weeks have got saved, incredibly. So this is the context. We've been going through the book of Acts, right? So Jesus said, wait for the Holy Spirit. Then he ascended to heaven. Then they chose another apostle. Then on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit fell. Then Peter preached. Then 3,000 were saved as a result of that message. And then another incident, they go into the temple. A guy who's crippled from birth gets healed. Then Peter preaches again about Jesus and the resurrection of the dead. That's where we find it. That stirs up trouble. So loads of people think it's great. Some people don't. The Sadducees, they are one of the four religious groupings in Israel of the time. Sadducees, Pharisees, Essenes, Zealots. They are the four religious groups of the time. The Sadducees you haven't heard much about until now, really. It's the Pharisees you've probably heard about in Jesus' time, yeah? But the Sadducees, they don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. They don't believe in a sort of spiritual realm. They don't believe in angels. They're kind of like modern-day liberals, social gospel-type people. It's like, so about religious and good works, but not the supernatural stuff. They don't like the apostles and what they're teaching, and so they want to stop them. It's a bit late in the day, so they put them in jail. Verse 5. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and the others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, by what power or what name did you do this? Okay, let's stop there again. So Luke wants us to get from this, it's like serious stuff. They've gathered together all the big hitters in Israel at the time. They've listed them there. They've got together the whole Jewish council called the Sanhedrin, 71 or so guys, right? Because this for them is serious. They've been bothered by Jesus. They got rid of Jesus. That's the end of it. But all of a sudden, like the disciples are coming back and they're still going on about Jesus and the resurrection of the dead. We've got to stop this, guys. So this is serious as far as they're concerned. And they ask the question, by what power or what name did you do this? In their theological framework, in terms of something powerful that happens, it comes from one of two sources, okay? And we would believe the same. Is it God? If it's not God, it must be the devil. It's the only two sources of power. That's their kind of framework. And so it was the same in Jesus' day again. They saw Jesus do incredible things. They couldn't deny the power, but they couldn't hack the thought that Jesus could be from God because they didn't like him. They didn't like what he said. So they said, you're doing that by the power of the devil, aren't you? That's what they said to Jesus. They're probably hoping it's the same with the apostles here, right? Verse 8, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and it being asked how he was healed. So Peter starts off really by saying, you're calling us to account, right, for an act of goodness which has led to someone being healed. Think about it. Do you really need to ask this question where this power comes from? It's pretty obvious. But then he goes on. Well, then know this. You and all the people of Israel, it is by the name, the authority, the power, of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified. Peter loves saying that. It's the third time he said it already. He loves telling people, you put him on the cross. You crucified Jesus. You crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Bold statements, right? Verse 13, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see that the man had been healed, standing there with them, so this guy was still with them now the next day, he's become a disciple, evidently, he's standing side by side, even though they've been threatened, there was nothing that they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin, and then they conferred together. What are we going to do with these men? They asked. Everyone in Jerusalem knows that they have performed the notable sign. And we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn them to speak no longer in this name. So then they called them in again and they commanded them not to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, what is right in God's eyes? Guys, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. We cannot help speaking about what we've seen and heard. After further threats, so they come back at them now. I'm telling you, if you carry on talking about Jesus, there is going to be trouble. So after further threats, they let him go. They couldn't decide how to punish them. They wanted to punish them, but they couldn't decide how to do it because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. Okay, that's that setting this morning. I've got 3 points for you, and they're all to do with telling people about Jesus, so they're all connected. And it's kind of like a how-to guide. And so the first how-to is how to be filled with the Spirit. I think there should be a screen with that up there. How to be filled with the Spirit. So if you go to verse 8, this is just before Peter is going to start speaking now to these guys who were challenging him in a pretty scary situation, okay? So it says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit. Filled with the Holy Spirit. Let me just talk to you just briefly about being filled with the Holy Spirit, because I think when we think about being filled with the Holy Spirit, the concept that we have in our minds is that it's some kind of ecstatic experience, right? And you get the filling of the Holy Spirit as a result of being in maybe a church service, a prayer meeting, where you feel the presence of God, there's an intensity about it, and then you have this incredible experience of the filling of the Spirit. And so I think that's the concept we have, but I don't think that's the most helpful concept that we have. I'm not saying that God doesn't give the Holy Spirit in situations like that. He does. But I think what we need to realize is that a couple of things. The giving of the Holy Spirit isn't a permanent state. So Peter and John, on the day of Pentecost, received the Holy Spirit. That wasn't permanent for them. It wasn't something that lasted then throughout their lives. They had to keep being refilled with the Spirit. You see in the next few verses that we're going to come to at the end of the message today, that after they prayed, they received the filling of the Spirit again. So they had to keep on being filled by the Spirit. Ephesians 5:18 says, keep on being filled on a regular basis, in other words, with the Holy Spirit. Now, this is a statement I want to make this morning, which is on the screen behind you, behind me, rather. The degree to which we are filled by the Spirit is directly related to the degree to which we are yielded to God. So the more we are yielded, the more we will be filled. Obedience, therefore, is the most important factor in being filled with the Spirit. This verb that is used to refer to Peter being filled is passive. So there's an implication there of a yieldedness on Peter's part to receive the Holy Spirit. And when you go through the book of Acts, you see that people are regularly filled with the Spirit. You see in chapter 5, in verse 3, a man who is walking the opposite way to God, and Peter says, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart? So Satan has filled his heart because he was walking in disobedience. We haven't got time to look at it this morning. If you look at Romans 8, the first part, if you look at Galatians 5, the end part, it talks about being led by the Holy Spirit, keeping in step with the Holy Spirit, and it's all connected with obedience. It really is. And so the key to being filled with the Spirit is not so much an intensity of an experience that you might have, it's being yielded, surrendered to God in your life so that he is able to fill you. If I could illustrate it this way. So if this glass is representative of our lives, and what's in it, what's in this glass is just our stuff, what we choose. So this would be a representation of a Christian who maybe once was living for God, but now has decided, I just want to kind of do my own thing, live my own way, make up my own laws, and do as I please every day. And imagine now this person is there on a Sunday, and they're saying, oh God, I really want an experience of the filling of the Holy Spirit, and so on. Can God fill that person with his Holy Spirit? He can't, can he? Because they're already full of themselves. And so I guess we need to be more like this, with the glass representing us and being in a place of surrender, of yieldedness, of saying to God, God, I just want to serve you. I want to do what you want me to do. And then we're in a position where God is able to fill us with the Holy Spirit. So we're able to be used by him. So that really is key for us, guys. And you know, I think a lot of us think, how is it that we can get an experience of God on a Sunday and then on Monday it's gone? And then on Tuesday, it's not there. And it's like, oh, we can't live that way. Well, that's not the way it's meant to be. It's meant to be that we are meant to be yielded to God on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. And so throughout the week, we still have that experience, not necessarily a feeling, but that state of, but God is still in me. And he can still use me. And he can still work through me in a powerful way, which is what the Holy Spirit does, because I'm yielded to him. So the challenge of my first point this morning is, how yielded to God are you and I in our lives at this moment in time? There may have been occasions in your life where you felt, you know, I'm really living for God, I'm really on fire for God, I just want to please God, and you get up every day and you say to God, God, use me today. I am yours to be used by you. Jesus is Lord, not me. But maybe you've slipped from that. Can I just encourage you to get back to that point where you would say, God, I want to be yielded to you again. I want to give my life over to you. I want to do in every area what you want me to do. Please, will you fill me with your Spirit? That's how to be filled with the Holy Spirit, point number one. Point number two, how to tell people about Jesus. Just a quick promo for Josh's talk a few weeks back on a Sunday night on evangelism. I wasn't there, but it's supposed to be excellent. Some really practical tips on how to talk to people about Jesus. But here's the context. Verse 12. Have a look at verse 12. This is the essence of Peter's message, right? When he says, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. It's one of the great statements of gospel preaching that you will read in the Bible. And so from that, I would say there's two main points, main factors in talking to people about Jesus. And they are salvation and exclusivity. Salvation and exclusivity. Salvation, first of all, it's not the gospel if we say to people, God loves you. It's not the gospel if we say to people, Jesus will change your life for the better. It's not the gospel if we say to people, come to church because church is great. Now, none of those statements are incorrect, yeah? I'm not saying they're wrong, but what I'm saying is, in out of context, they actually can be misleading and unhelpful because they're not the gospel. They're not the essence of the gospel, right? No one will get saved through any of those kind of ways in. The gospel essentially is about salvation. That's what Peter is saying here. There's only one way to get to heaven, and that is through salvation. So what does that mean? Well, that means that we need to be saved. So the gospel is that we need to be saved because all of us do things that are wrong. We are all sinners. Sin is something inside of all of us. And we all fall short of God's standard. But on the cross, Jesus Christ died so that we could be forgiven. He died to take away all our sins so that we could be saved, have all our sins washed away. And we come to faith in Christ Jesus through repentance and belief in what he's done. Repentance, saying sorry for what we've done and turning our lives to follow him, and belief that he will forgive us all our sins. Then we are saved. That essentially, guys, is the gospel. That's it. Now, I know there's so many occasions where you think, I don't know if I could tell someone the gospel. I don't know if I'm able to do that. I don't know if you've ever really sat down with someone on an individual basis and explained the gospel to them. It's not difficult, is it, guys? I know it can be scary, and we'll come to that bit in a minute, but I just said the gospel there in 2 minutes. This is the most important thing that you and I can learn in our lives, is what the gospel is and how to say it to somebody. So really speaking, none of us should be in a situation where we think, I can't really tell someone the gospel, what would I say? 2 minutes, guys, that's it, yeah? 2 minutes, that's all it takes to learn what the gospel is. Re-watch this message this morning and think, I'm gonna learn what the gospel is. What is it? Essentially, it's about being saved, right? Why do we need to be saved? Because we're all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. What did Jesus do on the cross? He died for us to be forgiven so that through repentance and faith, we get saved. That's all the gospel is that we really need to be telling people. Learn that. That's the first part. And the second part, and this is the tricky part, I guess, the scary part, is exclusivity. So Peter says, so this is chapter 4, verse 12, yeah, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Now, this is the scary part, right? Because if we're saying that, then a lot of people are going to be thinking, how can you say that? What right have you to say that? That's your opinion. You can't say it like it's true. There's not necessarily one way. That's your opinion. And then that can really throw us, can't it? And we're like, oh, man, I don't want to come across as like being arrogant or pig-headed in some way. And so can I really say it like that? Can I really say that Jesus is the only way? It's easy for a preacher on a Sunday, maybe in church, to say it, but like when you're one-on-one with someone, it's really different, isn't it? Can I really say that? Yeah, we can, guys, we can. Let me put it this way. That every other idea of God and how you get to God is simply that, right? It's us or people following what somebody has said in the past, a man and a woman, the beginning of a religious formation, a religious movement. And they've said, basically, this is what I think God is all about, and this is what we have to do to get to God. They might say, which they normally would, that I've had divine inspiration. It's come from a divine source. But essentially, it's one person saying, this is my idea. So how do you check that? How do you verify it? You can't. You can't check it. You can't verify it. You can't challenge it. It's someone's idea. Christianity is very different. Christianity is not about one man's ideas. Christianity is about a person and an event. It's about this incredible person, Jesus, who claimed to be God. Who claims to be God and gets away with it like Jesus did? And it's about an event. It's about an event which includes that same person where he died on a cross and rose again from the dead. And our faith as believers is in that person and that event, not someone's ideas. And it's verifiable because you can put it to the test. Because Jesus says, you trust in me, you believe in me, and you will be saved. You will know forgiveness of sins. You'll just know it. You will be born again. You'll be changed on the inside. You'll know a powerful work will go in on the inside. And you'll be brought into a relationship with God. You won't find that anywhere else in this entire world. And so you guys who've done that this morning, you did that. You trusted in Jesus. You knew a change. You knew you were brought into a relationship with God. You know that Jesus is real. You know that he is the Savior of the world. He is the only Savior in this world. There's no other Savior. No one else has died to take away sin. And so, yes, we can proclaim it with confidence and with boldness and with the exclusivity of it is Jesus. It has to be Jesus. It's only Jesus. That's not arrogance. And so we say it boldly. We say it unashamedly. We say it unapologetically. But we say it with gentleness and respectfully and with love, as the Bible tells us to. And it's not easy either. And it wasn't easy for the apostles. So I mean, look at what was happening here. So verse 2, it says, the people were greatly disturbed. They preach an amazing message, and they're disturbed by it. Then you go on to verse 18. They commanded them, stop speaking. And then verse 21, after further threats, they threatened them. Did it matter to Peter and John? It didn't. It's like, this is the message. We have to tell people about salvation in Jesus. It is just Jesus. And it doesn't matter if there are some people who don't like it. We don't change the message. I want you to imagine the scenario now, right? So they're brought before this really scary group of people, the main group of people in the nation of that day. It would kind of be like me maybe being on the streets and talking about Jesus or whatever, and then getting arrested and brought before the Welsh Assembly. And everyone in the Welsh Assembly, doesn't matter what political party they're from, so all the MPs, all the AMs, all of them, they're all gathered there. And to a man and a woman, they're saying to me, stop talking about Jesus. We don't like it. You keep doing it. It's a hate crime, call it, well, I don't know, whatever they want to call it, and we'll bang you up. You'll put you in prison. Imagine that. Imagine the whole of the Welsh Assembly is against me and kind of against you guys because I'm the pastor of the church here, right? And so I come back, and on the Sunday, and I say, oh, guys, this is what happened. How would it make you feel? How would it make me feel? I bet you the temptation would be, we maybe got to think about how we're going about this. This is not a good thing, is it? Like the whole Welsh Assembly, not just the government, but the whole kind of like all the political parties, they don't like what we're doing. Maybe we need to pull it back a little bit. Maybe we need to rethink our approach. Maybe we need to kind of just focus on doing good things in the community for a while. And then, like, when we've won people back over, then we start to maybe gently tell them about Jesus, but do it in a particular way. Honestly, that would be really tempting. And that's the situation that the apostles found themselves in, but it didn't stop them. It's like, we have to just tell people about Jesus. And as scary as it was, they did it, and God did amazing things. And one more thing before we get onto our third and final point. You might think, but these are the apostles, right? These are special guys. I can't do what they can do. Well, verse 13, it says this. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And they took note that these men had been with Jesus. So the Greek word here for the word ordinary is idiotai. Can you guess what word we get in our English from that? It didn't quite mean that in those days, idiots. But what it meant is like they were uneducated and unskilled. They were just normal people. That's what shocked them. So these are the best of the best in terms of the Sanhedrin. So well educated, so intelligent. And you get these apostles, and they know they haven't got that level of education. They're not particularly intelligent guys. And they stood toe-to-toe with the Sanhedrin. And actually, they really did very, very well in front of them. And so, guys, what makes the difference for you and me then? Because we don't need to be intelligent. We don't need to be well-skilled at talking to people. What made the difference? The difference was the Holy Spirit and just a desire to tell people about Jesus. That's the difference. God can use you if you're prepared to be yielded to Him and receive the Holy Spirit and just to tell people about Jesus. He'll give you the words. He'll help you with the words. Last point this morning, how to pray for boldness. Now, they needed to pray for boldness because I think they were scared. We're going to get to this point now where they're praying for boldness. Why were they praying for boldness? I think because they were scared. They'd just been threatened by the big, powerful people in the land at that time. And that's scary. So in their minds, they're thinking, we've got to talk about Jesus. We can't help talking about Jesus. We know it's right to talk about Jesus. But boy, this is a freaky situation that we're in, and I'm pretty scared. And so they needed to pray for boldness, and this is how they did it. And this is how we pray, not just for boldness, but for loads of things, actually. So let's just go through this section now to finish off with this morning. Verse 23. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. That's what they did. I think if I'd have come back from the Welsh Assembly and I told you everything had happened, what would be the first thing we would do? Tell you what I would do first. I'd be chatting. We'd have a meeting with the leaders. We'd be talking about what we would do. Perhaps we convene the whole church together. Let's think about what we're going to do here. We've got to plan this all out. That's the way I work. I try and fix things by working them out in my head, first of all. What did these guys do? It seems that they didn't actually try to work anything out. The first thing they did was pray. That's the first thing that we need to do, guys, whenever we're faced with any situation. Point number one, pray. Point number two, they prayed truth about God. You know when you're faced with a really difficult situation, it feels like a giant, right? So the situation comes, it's hard. It's like, oh my goodness, how can I cope with that? Giant little me. How am I going to deal with this? I don't know. I'm going to, in terms of my expectation of a good result, very, very low. So what the disciples did, the followers of Jesus, they prayed truth about God. They remembered things about God as they were praying. And what that did was supercharge their faith. It kind of fueled their faith by remembering that God was on their side. And so this is what their prayer went like. Verse 24 again, Sovereign Lord. That's where they started. They remembered that God is sovereign. And so they were up against the leading people of the Jewish government, at least of the day, that were in control and were telling them to stop. But then they were saying, but God, you are sovereign. So they're powerful, but you are up here. You are the one who's ultimately in control. And you ultimately being in control doesn't mean everything's going to go well, because we've just been banged up in prison and it was going to get worse for them. But what it does mean is that you still are in control and you will work things in the most incredible way. We believe that, so we can rest in that. There's peace and there's rest in knowing that ultimately we believe God is in control. Second thing, they remembered that God is the creator. In other words, he's really powerful. It says, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. Again, it's saying, we really want something to happen here, right? We want boldness. Can God give us boldness? Can God work in this situation? Well, for goodness sake, he can he? If he made this universe, if he just said, let there be, and then these stars appeared, and these far-flung galaxies and this incredible world in all its detail, if he can do that, then he can certainly do this. It's an argument from the greater to the lesser, isn't it? So yeah, God is so powerful, and we rest in his power. He's sovereign, he's powerful. Thirdly, they remembered that God is a God of wisdom. He gives wisdom. So he says, you spoke through the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of your servant, our father David. You've done this before. Why do the nations raise and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against the anointed one. And so they're remembering, you gave that wisdom to David before when people were against him. And you're giving it to us now as like a word that was given to them to sort of remind them, don't be confused about what's happening. Don't be shocked. This stuff happens, right? You will get people who will oppose Jesus. It's okay. So it's like, it's a word of wisdom and revelation for them. And then one more, it was, they realized that he's a wonder-working God in every situation. And so the next verse, verse 22, is it verse 22? I can't see. Verse 27, is it? Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. So they're thinking back to like, do you know, Pilate was against Jesus. The Jewish leaders were against Jesus. King Herod was against Jesus. They put him on the cross. But you were working in it in the most incredible way to bring about salvation for this world. You're a wonder-working God through the most incredible situation, right? We've just been arrested. We've just been threatened. It can almost seem like it's out of control. But we serve a wonder-working God who, even in this awful, difficult situation, is going to do something amazing. We believe that. That might be a word for somebody here this morning, that you might be in such a tough situation and you struggle to maybe see God in it at this moment in time. And God is a wonder-working God, even in tough situations, to bring about some incredible things. So they supercharged their faith. They fueled an expectation that, wow, God's going to do something amazing here. We know we need to tell people about Jesus. We want boldness to do so. And we've just reminded ourselves that God is powerful, and he's going to do something here. And then this is what happened. After they, no, one more point. They prayed specifically. Verse 29, "Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to preach your word with boldness. Stretch out your hand and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." They just said it then, right? This is what we want, God. We want boldness. We want to see you work in a miraculous way. Will you do that? Real faith. And then verse 31, after they prayed, this is the result. The place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God boldly. Now, I can't say to you today that if we pray that way, that this building will literally shake, as did happen at that particular point. But I think there was a reason for that. I think that it happened back then because God wanted to demonstrate in the physical way what he will always do in a spiritual way when he gives the Holy Spirit. So when the people of God are determined to yield themselves to God and be filled with the Spirit, when they're determined to talk about Jesus, and then when they seek God to help them to do so, God will give his Spirit and he will shake things. See, there are so many barriers against us doing what we should be doing as a church. So many brick walls, if you like, that would come against us. This is God saying, but you know, in the spiritual realm, I will send my Holy Spirit and nothing will be able to stand against you. These walls will come tumbling down because I will shake them. So how do we tell people about Jesus? We need to be yielded to him in order to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We need to tell people about salvation in Jesus, and it's just Jesus. And we need to be confident and bold and unapologetic, as well as gentle and loving and kind in the way we do so. And we need to be able to pray for boldness to do it, because it's scary. I don't think there's many people here who would be able to say anything other than it's scary to talk to people about Jesus. But guys, that's what all of us need to be prepared to do, right? Should we pray together? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for an example that we've read about this morning of how the first followers of Jesus did it, how they talked about Jesus, how they told the gospel, how they didn't stop, and how you used them even when the situation was difficult, tough, scary, intimidating, frightening. And God, if we're honest, we all feel that way in telling anybody about Jesus, God. Whatever it is that we need to hear from you and learn from you, may we do so in Jesus' name. Amen.
We stand together.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again, holy. we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Christ alone back. Let's just sing this, standing with voices aloud here this morning. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. And he goes on to say, what heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Shall we sing that together?
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought.
Here in the love of Christ, I stand.
thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you for your word this morning. Thank you, God, that, oh, God, we just thank you, God, for all that you are. God, we pray for that boldness, God. We pray, God, for the boldness to share your wonderful gospel. How can we not? How can we not? We have just proclaimed no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Until he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ, I stand. May that be our heart's desire for everyone that we meet along the way, that they can sing those words, knowing that they're true, knowing that it's true of their journey, of their story. Help us not to keep what we know locked in a cupboard, way out of the way, God. But help us to be lights that shine throughout this place. In your precious name, we pray. Amen. Please take your seats, guys.